Good afternoon and welcome to the Smart Woman Savvy Money 2010 webinar series. 30 minutes on the clock, 20 minutes to teach and 10 to talk. Smart Women Savvy Money is a platform offered through Urban Wealth Management designed to provide women with the tools and resources they need to create the life they desire and deserve. Our mission is to create a safe and secure environment where women are encouraged to learn, explore, and feel confident about making good financial decisions. Our calls are held the second Thursday of each month from 1 to 1:30 Pacific time. We like to stay relevant and bring our listeners timely topics that can enhance their lives. Next month's webinar, Kimberly Davidson, family law attorney, will be our guest speaker for, oh no, he said, she said, the D word, D meaning divorce. Kimberly specializes in collaborative solutions, helping to keep you and your business out of the courts. In August, Urban Wealth Management team member Diane Manuel will share easy breezy tips to get your financial life in order, put strategies in place to stay on track, and best practices for monitoring your progress. For the schedule of webinars, as well as other events and activities, please visit our website at www.urbanwealthmanagement.com. Before we get started on today's exciting talk, I'd like to cover a few housekeeping items. All our lines are muted because our calls are recorded. The replay link will be sent out a few hours after today's call for future reference. And if you're so inclined, feel free to share the link with others. We don't mind. Comments or questions? Just post them in the chat box, and we'll make sure to address them. We know you're busy, so that's why we keep our talks to 30 minutes. So, but feel free to reach out and engage us directly, and we're also open to ideas about future topics and webinars, so let us know what you'd like to hear. Now, for today's talk, no doubt if you own real estate, it probably represents a sizable portion of your asset base. But just like investing in the stock market, it has its cycles, ups and downs, pros and cons. And certainly having gone through this last major economic downturn, everyone felt the crunch and pinch of depressed real estate prices. But now we're on the other side of that. And as a result, there have been a number of shifts from a demographic, economic, and regulatory standpoint. Today's guest speaker, Nancy Harris, is a consummate real estate professional and is unique in that she's been licensed as a real estate broker for the past 20 years and has spent 22 years in the mortgage finance business, including 12 years as owner of her own mortgage finance brokerage firm. For the past 4 years, she's been solely focused on assisting her clients, the real estate transaction side, for both purchases and sales. And with that, I'll turn it over to Nancy.
Good afternoon. And thank you, Renee. I really appreciate the opportunity to share with your Urban Wealth Management and other colleagues for our presentation on real estate trends. And I just want to say that working with Renee has been a joy over the many years, and she is one of the most knowledgeable people in her field. And again, I couldn't do it without her. So Renee, kudos to you, and thank you again for this opportunity.
Thank you. I'll send you your check for your marketing.
All right. Well,
but we're in the Mutual Admiration Club, so I have to say that I've been working with Nancy and have referred a number of my clients to Nancy for both mortgage and real estate transactions. So we both have been helping each other out over the years. So kudos to you as well.
Thank you very much. So as Renee said, I've got over 25 years worth of real estate and mortgage finance experience, 20 years as a licensed real estate broker, and most of my years in the real estate mortgage finance business has been on the finance side, with the last 4 years specifically focused on real estate sales and purchases. I've assisted over 1,500 individuals and families realize the dream of real estate ownership. And let me tell you, it's never been a dull moment. And what I've learned over the last 25 plus years, I've been around long enough to have seen a few busts and a few booms. And saying that, it's really going to my third bullet point, real estate is cyclical. And I put the caveat on there, don't get caught. Now, that's a tricky piece of the whole puzzle. It's much like stock market and your investments in that arena. It's cyclical. There are cycles of boom and there are cycles of bust. But the second bullet point, real estate is really an investment strategy, or I should say we should all look at real estate as an investment strategy, as well as shelter. I know individuals that have worked very regular jobs, not six-figure income individuals, six, seven-figure income individuals, not your Donald Trumps, if you will, of the world. But I know people that have made real estate investments, buying a small house here every year or every other year, you know, amassing a pretty substantial real estate portfolio. And then when it came to their retirement time and they literally cashed in those properties, they were multimillionaires. So don't ever forget that real estate is an investment strategy, and the most important thing for the regular persons, as ourselves, it is a long-term strategy. It is more of a buy-and-hold strategy as opposed to if you're in the real estate business yourself doing buying and selling and flipping, that's another side of it. Where individuals do try to catch those cycles. But if that is not your business and you are looking at real estate as a piece of your investment strategy, it is a long-term investment strategy. And we'll talk a little bit more about that as we go along. Now, one of the things also on the last bullet point, one of the things that I have spoken about and blogged about, and you can read my blog article about this, is that you have to have money. You have to have liquid cash to really own and maintain real estate over the long haul. One of the problems that we had in the Great Recession that just passed, and our downturn in 2007-2008 that lasted a period of time, people did not have that cash to maintain. And so here's the lesson with real estate. Once you buy real estate, it's yours. Nobody loves that piece of property and real estate more than you. And it is your responsibility, whether we're in a boom cycle or a bust cycle, to continue to own that property, whether you have a renter or you don't, or whether you have a job or you don't. It is your responsibility to still hold on and make those payments if you have got a loan attached on that property. So you got to have some cash. So I've told a few war stories in my blog article about having cash and the downfalls of not having cash. So for those of our listeners out there that haven't purchased yet and are looking to get into the real estate market, or even if you're looking to expand your portfolio, just remember, make sure you check yourself and make sure you've got some reserves because, believe me, something is going to happen something big is going to happen when you own property that will take your funds. So today we'll explore three areas. We're going to look at one impact on the mortgage side of the equation is TRID, and that stands for Truth in Lending RESPA, TILA RESPA Integrated Disclosures. As a result of the downturn, it has changed the laws, as we all know, and that is one impact on the entire real estate cycle that can have a major effect. Secondly, we're going to look at general market observations and trends, and then finally we'll wrap with what do we do next. So to begin, TRID, again, which stands for TILA, which is Truth in Lending, RESPA Integrated Disclosures. These are your upfront and at the end of your transaction disclosures. And they're designed to give the consumer a better understanding of what they're getting early on so that the consumer can go out and make and shop and compare and make different decisions perhaps about what type of financing they're going to achieve. This has been an outgrowth of the Dodd-Frank bill, which is a massive bill, which changed the entire landscape, if you will, of mortgage financing, including banks as well as the mortgage broker side. And TRID has specifically changed the financing process. And what a consumer needs to know about Triad, a couple things. First of all, my fourth bullet point is that you will receive a loan estimate at the start. Whenever you call your lender or mortgage professional up and just have a general conversation, they are then to give you a loan estimate even before you start the formal process. And then at closing, you get a detailed closing disclosure before you actually close, and you have a certain amount of days in which to review that to make sure everything is as you were told. Now, where it gets tricky and as it relates to the real estate process is you have to make certain you have enough time to close, because there are certain aspects as it relates to these disclosures that if you make a change, decide that perhaps you want a different kind of loan product, or something material changes in your scenario from your side, from, you know, the money side or whatever it may be, this then triggers, perhaps, potentially triggers another redisclosure of the forms, which then adds time. Because once a form is redisclosed, you have X amount of days in which to review that and then proceed on. So you've got to make certain that you have a very close conversation with your mortgage professional before and during while you're in a real estate transaction to make sure that you've got enough time to close. I've had several conversations as I've been assisting our clients over the last 9 months, because TRID went into effect almost 12 months now, technically went into effect of August of 2015. But what we found is that 30-day transaction we all talked about and we all want, 30-day or less, oftentimes if there is a loan involved, the mortgage professional has advised us, the real estate professional, that we will not be able to get this done in 30 days based upon TRID disclosures. So just know that. So again, the point being, make sure you get your loan estimate up front. Make sure you review your closing documents. But more importantly, at the beginning, make sure you have a discussion with your mortgage professional and make sure you have enough time to close within the closing time stated in your contract. Moving on to talk a little bit about trends. So there have been some trends that we have seen as we've gone into 2016, from late 2015 into 2016. And the first one being home ownership is actually down across all age brackets. We're about, I want to say it's about 15% down from the highs of 2006-2007, and this is according to the California Association of Realtors as well as the National Association of Realtors. Home ownership is down. And one of the reasons, the biggest reason was the effects of the recession. The recession had many outcomes and many down points as it's affected the real estate environment. But the biggest one is that it has changed attitudes. Real estate now is not the definition of the American dream as it once was, as it was for many decades. That was the true achievement of the American dream, if you were able to buy your own house and able to be even more lucky and buy even more property. But it's not that these days, especially with millennials coming up. Millennials are not as excited about purchasing property. They don't see that, purchasing a home, they don't see that as the end-all, be-all as other generations did. And so that has really changed, and that has had an impact on the real estate industry and home ownership. The other thing is millennials and the generation before millennials, it escapes me the name right now, but it's taking them longer to enter the real estate market. So they are not jumping in, you know, the minute they're 25 years old and have acquired some money to through their careers, and not necessarily jumping into home ownership. That is why in many areas, especially urban areas across the country, the rental market is active. I know here in Los Angeles, all the new construction going up in the inner city areas are mostly rental, large rental complexes. And this is a result of not only the attitudes towards home ownership, but also we have the other large generation, the baby boomer generation, who are now starting to sell their real estate and may look to retirement communities as well as even rentals. So continuing on with trends, having said all that, the next thing that we should, though, keep in mind, there is some bright sides to this. The market should stay relatively strong. Now, having said all the things I just said on the previous slide, that does not mean people are not buying. People are definitely still buying. In fact, home prices are expected to see moderate growth, 4.3 in home prices increasing in 2016, and then home prices even up 3.9% in 2017. So there's still going to be growth. We're still in a growth mode. Prices are starting to appear to what we call level off in the real estate arena. And there, because coming off of the big, there was a big boom in pricing that happened from 2012 to 2013, where prices really uptick dramatically. And then we've kind of stabled off, still with some moderate growth, and again, moderate growth expected in 2016 and again in 2017. The other trend is that minority buyership is up. And this is something that over the decades, over the last 25 years that I've been in the real estate business, there's always been a push to make sure minorities have the opportunity to purchase properties. And so now we're actually seeing the positive effects of that, and minority home ownership and buyership is up. That's a big thing. The next item is the share of second and vacation homes, another trend. That's up after some declines in 2013 and 2014, and this is a lot in the baby boomer range, where individuals are either selling or now buying. They may sell their bigger home that they raised their family in and now buying a couple smaller homes and buying vacation homes in different parts of the country. We definitely see an uptick trend in that area. And then last, there is indication that homeowners now are keeping their properties longer before selling. There was a time in the mid-2000s, we'll just say in the early to mid-2000s and even prior decades, where people would hold their properties maybe 2 to 3 years, you know, sell and try to get something bigger, then again, you know, sell to try to get something bigger as long as rates held up. And it's not so. In the last 10 years, the turnover in properties has slowed down, and it appears as if homeowners are keeping their properties 10 years before they're even thinking about selling, which, again, I think is smart and bodes to the comment about real estate being a long-term strategy. Continuing on with some points on first-time buyers. First-time home buyers, of course, that population has gone down also too, and for you first-time home buyers out there, it is actually a little harder to buy nowadays. Gone are the days of the 100% financing, although that's still available if you're a veteran and in some form. So it hasn't totally gone away. However, veterans, I'm getting off a little bit on a tangent here, but for veterans, the 100% financing option has always been there. So that was nothing new. It was always there and is still there. So if you are a veteran, I would strongly encourage you to look into entering into the home ownership arena and property ownership arena. But continuing with my thought there, first-time home buyers, it is harder. The amount of down payments is higher. And I do have a caveat there because FHA financing is still available, which allows for a 3.5% down payment. So there is still ways to get in with smaller down payments. But in general, we're seeing most of our buyers coming in, first-time buyers, with much higher down payments. And the other thing that's challenging for first-time buyers is that they are being beat out often by all-cash buyers, especially in many urban areas. We as real estate professionals bemoan this, that some of our first-time home buyers, you know, we may have to put in 6, 7, 10 offers to, you know, running from those all-cash buyers. And however, though, in saying that, there is a myth out there that a seller will always take an all-cash buyer, which is not true. It all depends upon how the deal is structured, how comfortable the seller and the agent feels with the all-cash buyer. So as first-time buyers or as buyers, period, as you're out there, don't always think that a seller is going to take an all-cash buyer because that actually is not true. However, though, you first-time buyers do experience some disappointment when they do get beat out by all-cash buyers. There's still a lot of individuals out there on the sidelines with a lot of cash. So the all-cash buyers are still out there and will be out there for a while. But as prices increase, that could slow down a little bit, could potentially. So then what's a person to do? What should you do? Well, first of all, don't be scared. If you're a first-time buyer, you've not owned real estate before, don't be scared. Get out there and meet with your mortgage professional first thing, because your mortgage professional is going to be able to tell you, you know, what you qualify for and the actual steps through the process. Those of our clients out there that have properties already and are wondering what to do and wondering if this is still a viable strategy, absolutely it is. And you also, don't be scared. Get out there. Consider purchasing now. That's to everybody. Consider purchasing now. The benefit of now is interest rates are still low. They're still historically low. So that makes the real estate market a lot more attractive. Now, it was forecast that in 2016 we would see some major increases in interest rates. That has, as of yet, as we speak in June here, as of yet, that hasn't happened. So although we do, as everybody is well aware, we do have an election coming up, and we don't know how that's going to impact 2017 and going forward. So if you are able, or you want to find out if you're able to purchase, now's the time. And my also one other piece of advice is, if you are considering purchasing, consider purchasing rental and investment property. That, again, as I spoke earlier, that is the trend. Rentals are in demand, not as many people jumping in early in their age, in their life, to actually purchase property. So the rental market is viable. In many areas across the nation, there is an affordable housing crunch. Not that you all are going to get into the affordable housing arena. That's a whole other story. But just housing, period. So rental housing is in demand, and that's okay also, too, as a first-time purchase. In fact, myself, that was the first purchase I made, was not a home for myself. I bought a 3-unit apartment building. So consider doing purchases and really looking at rental and investment properties rental and investment properties as a purchase, as your first purchase. It also can make a lot of sense if you live there also. So you can spend a year living in your rental property and maybe giving yourself some relief from, or at least some help in making that payment. So don't be scared. Jump in there. Do what you got to do. Do your research. Speak with your mortgage professional. Speak with Renee and see how real estate fits into your portfolio. And don't be scared. It is a way to acquire wealth. It is a retirement strategy. So don't be scared. Jump in. And if you want to get in touch with me, as I conclude my part of the presentation, if you want to get in touch with me, I have there's my information for a website, email, phone, Facebook me, tweet me, LinkedIn, and of course Instagram. I look forward to answering any of your questions and all of your questions, and hopefully help you enter or continue to be strong in the real estate arena and on your way to a path for wealth. So I thank everyone for listening this afternoon, and Renee, thank you once again for having me. And now I'm open to questions.
All right. Thanks, Nancy. And I do want to let everyone know, Nancy was talking about her blog, and it is listed here on the website at UrbanWM. And it's a great article because she talks about, just like she's talking about right now, having cash, having some liquidity. She did talk about in her blog about her first experiences when she bought some property, and as luck would have it, something went wrong within, I guess, a few months of buying the property, and had she not had any liquidity, there would have been some major problems. So I direct you to the site because she has a very insightful blog, and Nancy is one of our contributing bloggers, so feel free to come to our site and read more and more about some of the other topics that we have there as well. So while we're waiting for that, I do have, there were a couple questions that were posed during the talk. One of them is a question about, you talk about rental property as being a, you know, it's a good market. Can condos kind of fit into that? Are you, how is that in relationship to rental property? Or is rental property better if it's a house or a duplex?
Well, it is. That's a good question. Condo absolutely can be a rental property. A couple things to keep in mind about condos and townhouses is that you do have your HOA, your homeowners association, to keep in mind. So you have to check with them to make sure, you know, they don't have any restrictions against, you know, you renting out the property. That's one. And that you do have to keep in mind with your homeowners fees. So, because you, in condos, even with renting out houses, even with, you know, apartment buildings, you know, you want to look at your cash flow. You want to make sure that this makes sense to you on a cash flow basis. But I'll share with you a quick story. One of my clients just literally the other day told me she has a condominium that they had been renting out for the last, you know, 10 years. And then they made the decision to put it on Airbnb. So they are not interested in any, from this point on, in doing long-term rentals. They're only interested in doing Airbnb rentals. And
wow.
I know. I who knew? I didn't even think of that. They apparently are going to make more money. It's going to make more sense from a cash flow perspective to do that. And so, you know, with new things that new techniques and technology that's out there now, there are different ways to skin the cat. So that proved to be very beneficial from them. And this, again, is a condominium. So that's something
to
think about. I was impressed with that. Yes.
Okay, because I would think that a lot of condos and HOAs, and I hear this often, are against Airbnb rentals because they feel that it's, you know, it's disruptive. There's a lot of traffic and a turnover. So that your client was very lucky that their HOA allowed that.
Yes.
Maybe the HOA doesn't know it.
Well, that could be true too, Renee. But that's why
we
I did. That's why I did preface my comment with, you know, you got to check your homeowners association, make sure
right,
it's okay.
Right, right. Okay, all right. So we also had another question about, can you use your retirement assets, specifically, let's say, your 401k, to buy real estate? I'm going to let you answer that first, and then I have some commentary from a financial planner's perspective, some caveats about that.
Yes. So I will switch and put on my go back to my mortgage training and say that it's definitely a form that can be used for down payment. From what I remember back from my real estate finance days, and I'm pretty sure it hasn't changed, one of the things that lenders are concerned about is if when accessing those funds, is it going to be a loan? Because if it then is a loan, then that loan payment for you accessing your 401k has to be factored into the equation as part of your debt. Mm-hmm. And so just knowing a little bit about how the accessing of those funds is achieved and if there is a payback at a certain time, those are all the things that could be important in the to the real estate transaction and the client obtaining financing. So, but outside of that, it's definitely a form to use for purchasing properties, definitely. And some companies, you know, they'll let you use it for first-time buyers only. And so the advice to, from my perspective to our clients is just make sure they check their 401k administrator and see what the rules are for them to access for property purchasing.
Right, exactly. So that's a very good point. And just to build on that from a planning perspective, the rules around borrowing from a 401k are pretty much the same from plan to plan, although you do have to check, make sure that there are lending capabilities for your 401k plan, because some smaller plans don't allow for it. But that's the first thing. If you're at a major company, it won't be a problem. And the rules are that you can borrow up to 50% of your account value or $50,000 maximum. So if you're looking for a down payment on it, that could be a pretty nice a fair amount of money that you can come up with. But as Nancy just indicated, too, it is a loan. And as a loan, number one, it's not taxable when you take it out because you will be repaying it, but it does impact your cash flow, not only in terms of your current cash flow, but also think in terms of if you're taking this money out, you're borrowing from your future, essentially, and you need to kind of weigh that in terms of lost time invested in your retirement account. So that's I think is a key issue. The other thing that one can consider, if we just look at the broader picture of retirement accounts, if you have a Roth IRA, you can access whatever you've contributed to that Roth on a completely tax-free basis. So if you've been adding money to a Roth over the past 8 years, putting in your maximums, for example, you may have $30,000 worth of contributions that's been made. You can pull that money out without any taxes. The earnings on the Roth money you can't tap into because that has to stay in there until 59 and a half, after which time it's completely tax-free. But all your contributions you can pull out. If you have that and the 401k monies, then you've got a sizable bucket that you can pull from. And then if you have traditional IRAs, those where you took a tax deduction on the contributions, you can pull out up to $10,000 from your IRA account. You still have to pay taxes on it as income, but you will get around paying the pre-59.5 10% penalty. And that is a rule that is provided for first-time home buyers. But it's a pretty fluid definition according to IRS. If you haven't owned property, a primary residence, This is for primary residences only. If you haven't owned one in the previous 2 years, that qualifies you, believe it or not, as a first-time home buyer. So you can pull out up to $10,000 out of your IRA account without paying that 10% penalty. So there are some ways to do that and access your retirement funds. If you've got the right buckets of retirement monies, you could probably really make it work. So thank you for that question. And I think as a final question, we talked about in your presentation too, one of the trends is that we're seeing all cash buyers coming in. And I know that's got to be really discouraging, just from a perspective of, you know, where are we seeing more of that kind of flipping? Are those typically buyers that are flipping? They're coming in and buying it, or are they really buying it for long-term investment or as a primary residence?
You know, that it varies, actually, now. There was a time a few years ago, I would say probably in that 2009 to 2011-ish, early 2012 arena, where it was, you know, flipper mania. I mean, people were coming in, and it was totally flips. That has waned a little bit because home prices have gone up. So it's not quite as attractive to the flipper on a large scale. I mean, you know, there was a pool of properties, you know, that had been gone into foreclosure, et cetera, back in those days, and property was on the cheap. But as property prices have increased, you are starting to see not as many flippers in the market as you used to. However, they're still there. The last transaction I was involved in, which just closed about 2 or 3 weeks ago, we did have investors in looking at that property also, but we eventually sold to a family that was going to live there, and it was a two-unit property and rent out the back. So they're there, but I guess to really answer your question, I say all that to say answer your question, they're out there, but not quite in the numbers that they used to be. And, of course, it depends on property, too.
Yeah, I would imagine. I mean, the prices have appreciated quite a bit, so it's probably, I mean, it was easier, you know, as you said, a few years back, 6, 7, 8 years back, where prices had dropped, and so it was easier for those people who had cash, and that was your number one caveat, your number one lesson is have liquidity, have some cash. So that's perfect. So I want to thank you, Nancy. This was very informative, and I know that a lot of people were taking very good notes because we had some great questions. Looking forward to having you back and talking about, you know, again, developing trends in the real estate market. For our listeners, we do have some great webinars coming up, as I mentioned at the top of our talk. Next month, we will have the talk by a collaborative attorney who will be talking about the collaborative dissolution process. My Financial Fitbit, which is going to be led by Urban Wealth Management team member Diane Manuel. And then we will have our tech diva back in September, where she'll talk about cutting the umbilical cord. I know a lot of us are tired of carrying around those cables and cords to recharge and connect. And so she's got the 411 on how to do that. So having said that, goodbye, everybody. Thank you for spending your time with us today, and we look forward to having you with us again next month.